Hello, everybody. I'm closer and narrower than you were last time. It's a bit intimidating. Because we've got a brilliant panel, but a numerous panel, I'm going to kind of get people to introduce themselves as the questions roll along. The point of this panel, and I just want everyone to remember this because sometimes we do get bogged down in discussions about what the situation in the industry is now. We're looking to obviously not solve every single problem that is thrown up by streaming because we'd be here till next Christmas, but we are looking to at least examine what can be done in the current environment and see what the best route forward would be for all stakeholders in the industry. It would be remiss to begin, continue, or even conclude a discussion on the future of streaming without mentioning the biggest streaming service in the world, which is, of course, YouTube, and the fact that pretty much all music, depending on what's been taken down this moment in time, is available on that service, licensed, part-licensed, or otherwise. The question that I would like to ask the panel, and I will begin with Annabella at the end, is can we have a healthy industry while the biggest streaming service and the fastest growing streaming service is free? And please introduce yourself to the audience and tell us what it is you do.
Hi, I'm Annabella Koldrick. I'm Chief Executive of the Music Managers Forum. I started in January, so very, very quickly getting up to speed. I think you said that the biggest streaming service in the world is free. It's not technically free, it's advertiser funded and it is licensed, some may say under licensed. And I think in general for managers, the view has been that while that system exists and while that system is a way, that platform is a way to reach our fans, our challenge as managers is to monetize it in the best way possible. And often it's under monetized, so there is money there which managers can and should be claiming for their artists. So, I mean, a really good example is one of our manager members who's been in the industry for, gosh, nearly 40 years, I think. We run a series of educational seminars for our managers to get up to speed with how quickly the industry is changing and how they can open up different and more revenue streams for their artists. And he came to this and at the end of it went back and phoned up the label who his artist is signed to and said, "Why are we making money from all of this? Are we doing this?" And the label said, "Well, actually, it's not a priority for us at the moment with your artist. But hey, if you want to do it, go ahead and do it." 6 months later, £200,000. So it goes, and obviously that's a legacy artist with a lot of content that can be monetized. So ideally, obviously, YouTube would be paying more. However, there is money there, and we would encourage people to make sure they're making the most of it.
And quite on the point of looking to the future as well, so thanks for doing that. Charles, the fact remains that we are hearing a lot about the value gap, especially on YouTube, in terms of the level of consumption and the acceleration of the growth in that consumption and the money coming out of that service and others, but primarily that service. Can we have a healthy and growing industry while the biggest streaming service remains ad-funded, if not free?
So just quickly, I'm Charles Galdas, I'm the CEO of Merlin. We're the global rights licensing agency for the independent sector. And I have to be very careful what I say about YouTube because we're in business with them and we're doing the best that we can as well. But I think, you know, we do an annual survey every year which looks at the digital business of all of the labels we represent around the world. And if you consider that YouTube proudly touts that it has a billion users and a billion people coming to the platform, it's still, for across the entire membership, represented around 8% of their digital revenues, which I think illustrates a picture that needs fixing, right? So there's something very wrong with that picture. When the service where the most music consumption happens in the world also pays the least on a per cap, on a per head, per user basis, I think that's a huge challenge to the growth of a high-value industry. And I think the fact that the safe harbour provisions allow them to exploit that position, notwithstanding the fact that we're licensed it and are trying to bring them up the value chain, the fact remains that over time, more and more music gets used and listened to on YouTube and less money on a per usage basis comes out of it. So I think it's definitely one of the biggest sore points we have in our industry.
Maria, you are the designated voice of publishers today. Obviously, Charles, understandably, has his members have a right to be potentially upset by the figures they're seeing from YouTube. But as we know, we'll come on to the division of the streaming pie later, but as we know, publishers arguably get the raw end of the deal there, or certainly a smaller slice than others. How does YouTube stack up for a modern music publisher in terms of income seen? And are you confident anything can be done about it?
Well, that's quite a big question. Maria Forte Music Services. I run a rights management company, so I can deal with publishing. I am a publisher by training. I started in the late 70s in administration, so this is now quite an interesting area because it's become quite a hot potato. Basically, what YouTube have to do is build a functioning system that will be able to acknowledge copyright and pay the rights owners. And sadly, what's happened is they have built a system based on the American way of claiming copyrights, which is on a pre-claim basis, where publishers will give a digital service their catalogue, and then in this case, YouTube will say, well, this is what we've used, this is yours. It doesn't work like that over this side of the pond, and the societies who hold the rights in both mechanical and performance rights will claim on a post-claim. So they want to know what has been used, and then they will tell the streaming service and invoice them for that amount. So it's kind of the model has been sort of built the other way around, and so that's a very big problem. Another problem area is the fact that the content ID system, you have to go in at a very granular level, which constantly is changing, and either because other people are making claims to copyrights or the information in the first place is just simply wrong. So, major publishers have teams of people who are on that all the time to try and identify and match those works to claim them. So from a copyright perspective, from a claiming perspective, we're way, way behind. So the future for me would be sorting out something that actually even began to work.
Praise indeed.
Yes.
Ray, you might look at things as from a slightly different perspective from other people. Obviously, you're all about the bottom line in your line of work, but you're also about the data that you receive. And I wanted to know, how does YouTube compare while we're on the subject to other streaming services, and what would you like to see change?
Hello, everyone. I'm Ray Bush, Music Royalty Co. I think it's user generated, so that's obviously the challenge. You know, capturing it could be anywhere. You know, capturing the right videos and monetizing them in the right way is a lot harder than obviously the streaming membership taken care of. So I think that needs to change for a start. You know, if getting things into the right channels, monetizing it properly. Just to touch on the points, we see a lot of money not being monetized. I mean, I think everyone knows that. There's a load of money there. It's very difficult with the size of the data we deal with. You know, it's millions of lines, and actually extracting out of there the, you know, one file we receive from, for instance, is 8 million lines, and probably half of that is unmonetized. So that's just for one company. So for me to get ahead of that, understand it for a start, but also control what other people are doing. I mean, it's out of our hands to a degree. I think at the moment, it's the amount of money it takes to actually employ somebody to actually do these things is the reason they're still one unmonetized, really. We've seen in certain circumstances, if someone does bother to monetize it, it can mean a lot of money. It can mean a lot of money. But it leads into everything else you talk about, you know, transparency and all the rest of it. So I think obviously tech's got to catch up with the rest of the world. I mean, we've got to embrace it. I mean, even a company like me, I've been going for a year. We took the best system we had on the market, and I think we've actually reached a point where it's not good enough for us. It can't handle it, you know.
Just because there's too much data.
I had a company in America, a distributor. They rung me. They wanted us to outsource. I was like, you know, obviously going to take it or not going to try. They were receiving 35 million lines a month. And I was like, I can't even think about that.
Micropayments.
Yeah, I mean, they're giving, you know, how much of that's unmonetized and it goes on. So I think that's where we stand. I think we need tech support. You know, I think we're fighting a fight. We may be losing a bit. I also, you know, it's mainly because it's had it's user generated, in my opinion.
Things will get more positive once we move on from YouTube.
It's the window.
But, you know, Martin, why don't we kick it while it's down? YouTube for you, friend or foe? And can anything be done about the pain that it's causing your business, presumably causing your business?
First of all, I'm Martin from Cooking Vinyl. Also, I don't know if you guys want to sit over there, but there's four seats there that might be more comfortable than standing. So feel free to charge around or walk around the front, whatever. Don't be shy. It's in my mind, it's both. I mean, YouTube, I think, is a nightmare because we don't earn a lot of money on it. A lot of people have made that point. But it's kicked piracy into touch, which is something that you often forget. I mean, when I started a label, I wanted, you know, I was working with great music and I wanted people to hear it. That was my motive for starting a label. And YouTube has provided, is the biggest form of music consumption on the planet. You know, we used to go on and on and on about the problem of piracy. And YouTube's been the best thing for getting rid of piracy that we've seen. It's also taking over from radio. It hasn't taken over yet, but taking over from radio as a really important discovery tool. So there's a big friend side to YouTube. But then again, you look at how much we earn per stream, and you compare that to what we earn on premium services, and it's very, very significantly less. So there's a big foe side, and it's not an easy question to answer because I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We're earning good money from YouTube, and maybe the answer is that we need all these different income streams like YouTube and Pandora to complement Spotify. On the other hand, if we could accelerate usage from YouTube to Spotify, the industry would be in, or other premium services, the industry would be in much healthier shape. So there is a big question about how can we, I guess, tweak the business model, because YouTube, from the consumer's point of view, is fantastic. It's got all the video. It doesn't have windowing. Everything's up there. It's such a great service. And what we've got to do is come up with a premium solution that is more compelling to the consumer than YouTube. And if we can do that, then I think that the space will get very exciting because, you know, we're over the moon with the amount of revenue we're seeing from premium services already. But if we could increase it significantly, I mean, that's the bottom line. YouTube is growing far, far faster than premium services. If we could change that a bit, then, you know, the industry would be so healthy, it's not true.
Mark, you are the designated Spotify representative today. Just to remind the audience and certain headline writers in the audience, Mark isn't Daniel Ek. He's not here to speak for everything that Spotify do, but he has bravely volunteered himself onto the panel. On the subject of, let's call them free services, let's not name any particular brands, isn't that an advantage to Spotify in your argument for the freemium model, which obviously does differ from the free model in that ultimately there is a product people pay for at the end? There's been a lot of controversy around the free tier of Spotify. Some people are anti it. Some people will say we should follow the Netflix or Apple Music model. Spotify argues forcibly for it, and YouTube is a gem for you when you argue for it.
I've been thinking about answering the last question for 10 minutes, and now you ask me a different one.
Answer the last question if you like. Go ahead.
My name is Mark Williamson. I run the artist services team at Spotify. I mean, taking a step back, I think, look, you'd expect me to take a kick at one of our competitors in this situation, but I'm not going to. We start off the panel by suggesting we're going to list the challenges that streaming faces, and we don't mention the opportunities. One of the parts of the question was how we're closing the value gap, and if you look at what a range of services have done, including Spotify, is dramatically done that. I mean, if we show of hands now, how many people were getting their music predominantly from piracy 10 years ago? Hands, come on.
Okay. I think you've just given those headline writers a gift, right? I'm afraid to tell you, mate.
We've managed to take piracy from a position of absolute dominance down to almost nothing. Now, it doesn't mean that we're in a perfect position, but we're seeing markets grow. We've seen the overall market tail out and things grow again. So actually, we are, as an industry, we are finding ways to reduce that value gap. What's exciting now about where we are from a streaming perspective is that we've moved out of this kind of Punch and Judy style, like streaming's bad, streaming's good, where I get booed on every panel, and we're moving towards one of optimization, where we're talking about, okay, well, which ones work better and which ones work worse for different scenarios. And that's actually the exciting part that you know, we've talked about here, that there isn't a perfect solution on the market right now, but a combination of solutions are providing some quite interesting places to be. I think what we need to continue to do is not look at this stuff in a single time zone. This is something that's evolving over time. So there are different solutions, there's different per streamers, there's different services that offer different things, whether you're an artist, manager, label, publisher. And I think that's really important to look at it in that way. As somebody that's been at Spotify for 5 years and looks at the data every single day, free is still a key component of driving that value and driving premium subscription. We're still in a position where the largest number of subscribers on a streaming service come as a direct result of having a free service. Spotify has the largest amount of subscribers because of free. One thing I thought was interesting that Daniel talked about before is we're not religious about it. This isn't about free being free forever. It's just the best thing right now to drive value through subscription. And I think that other services, whether that be YouTube, whether that be Pandora, whether it's Apple, we all need to look at ways of convincing more people to pay for music on an aggregate basis. And this shouldn't really be this kind of tribal religious fight between free and premium. It's a blend.
Can I just add one thing, Tim, which is, we're very much looking at this from the point of view of the UK and basically the 10 or 12 rich markets in the world that drive music. But if you go further afield and look at China or India or Russia, you know, the potential of VK coming online with a freemium service with 120 million subscribers, the monetizing there, or Alibaba or Tencent in China with the freemium model, again, those income streams will be very significant for the industry. And it, given, you know, wages in those countries, it probably is the only option. I mean, you've had lots of success in Spain with the freemium level in terms of really changing the fortune of the music industry there, and it was in a very bad way.
Yeah, I mean, somewhere like Spain is a massive challenge because you can't apply the same thinking. I mean, we've tried so many things there, from discount pricing to discount onboarding to all sorts of things. The truth is that people right now are just not paying that subscription. So free is really where all the money in Spain comes from. And, you know, I guess another thing that is important then, given that exists, whether it be in an emerging market like China or a developed market like Spain that just hasn't got the economics, is we have to do the opposite as well. We have to look at making free pay better as well. So better advertising, better optimization, better ad units. And that's something that we are certainly doing a lot of. Of course, something like YouTube is doing a lot, and how do they sell more ads? So it's important that it comes from both ways as well, making free better as well as making premium pay more.
Quick one for Mark before I come back to the right-hand side of the panel. Spotify worked out recently its conversion rate is at an all-time high. Right, so all this talk around freemium and good thing, bad thing, the number of people who start on free, the percentage of people start on freemium and end up paying is at the highest at any point in Spotify history. How do you attract a YouTube addict into the Spotify ecosystem to set them on that path in the first place?
I think there's a number of ways. I think what we're doing now is we're putting more people in the top of the funnel than we've ever done, and we're converting more of them than we've ever done before. And that's because we're just getting better at it. It's, you know, we're like 10 years old this year. We're getting better at learning how to convert using the data, using things like our 99 cents for 3 months. So, for example, this illustrates how we get a YouTube or a casual or a radio subscriber. We used to say, hey, come and try Spotify for 2 months for free. And what we figured out was when the people got to that page and they had to put a credit card in, they would go, okay, well, now I'm being lied to, it's not for free, or they'd put it in and they'd never try Spotify. What we realized was when we said, hey, get 3 months for 99 cents, same kind of economics for us was, one, they didn't mind putting in a credit card, just a simple learning, like, because they knew they were going to have to pay 99 cents and they're going to pay it online. And then the second bit was, just because they'd paid anything, they were much more likely to log in on the first day and actually use the service, which is one of the hardest things that you could possibly do. It's like, someone signs up, I mean, how many apps on your phone have you never opened? Like, that kind of thing. So we're consistently looking at the behaviors that are happening on, why is somebody just listening to free radio? Why is somebody just listening to YouTube? And what we try and do is we try and capture that behavior once and then show them how much better of a service our premium subscription is or on-demand subscription is. So it's a little bit like, you know, in possibly a good way, it's like a bait and switch. We take a behavior that has become absolutely normal for many people, we change it slightly, and then we show how we can improve it. And that kind of thing is working incredibly. But let's not forget as well, if you open up, if you look at the phone of a teenager or any person who uses their smartphone regularly, they're not using just one app. So it's a long-term attritional battle as well. They might have SoundCloud, might have Pandora, might have YouTube, might have Spotify. Over time, you've got to prove yourself worthy of taking any money out of their pocket. And that's something that we've done incredibly well at doing, really.
Great, thank you. I think we'll start the bun fight now because I want to ask about the share of the revenue pie. I'm going to come back to Annabella. Are artists being paid fairly by streaming services in the first instance, but also when that money goes onto their labels? Same question for songwriters and publishers, but I'm sure Maria will specialise in that shortly.
Yeah, I think it's very interesting. As I say, I've only been in the job for, 8-9 weeks now. And when there are many managers I talk to, and particularly with artists who self-released at the start of their careers, and the amount of money they see coming in directly through streaming, very, very transparently, can really help. It helps them build their fan base, potentially globally, not just at a local level, and it really helps them, take off their careers and start to fund their careers. However, what's perhaps even more interesting is the disparity between those artists who may be self-releasing through TuneCore or indeed with smaller indie labels and those who are signed to major labels and the inability of them. We talk about the value gap between the DSPs and essentially the rights holders, but then the gap again between the rights holders and the creators is really potentially quite significant. And there is an issue around transparency, and there's an issue because of the lack of transparency around trust, which is why I was down in Margate at the weekend with a friend who just spent £34 on vinyl records. And he said to me, I said, I'm doing a panel on Monday. One of the things we're talking about is streaming. He said, oh, yeah, I use Spotify, but I feel guilty all the time because the money's not going through to the artists. And I said, well, it is. Even if it's ad-funded, it is. And he said, oh, yeah, and I use it to then go and buy more records. So, the money is there, but that lack of trust, because he'd heard and read those stories where people have got only a part of the information and they're seeing so little through the chain, means that he doesn't have trust in the music he's consuming. And it's those people we want to have trust. So there is a question around transparency. There's a question when we come to things like NDAs, so we can't see the terms of the deals that have been done between the labels and the streaming services. Issues of things like sharing breakages, which now the majors are saying they will do, and equity, which Warner's and Sony are now saying they'll do, but Universal haven't yet moved on. So there's an issue of transparency and there's an issue of trust. And then there's another question, I think. The more that streaming takes off, which it is, and it's fantastic, it is leading to huge opportunities for artists and their managers, but how it's treated by labels. So it's being treated as a sale in the same way as a physical product was sold or as a download. And actually, we are seeing now cannibalization from what was downloads into streaming, but also from broadcast. And broadcast, as many of you will know, broadcast radio is subject to equitable remuneration. So regardless of whether or not you're signed to a major and whether or not you've paid back your advance, whether you're unrecouped, you still see money come through when your record is played on the radio, depending on how much and where it's played, but you still see that money come through. And for many artists, that's absolutely critical at a certain stage of their career where they need that income. And I think over time, we are hugely supportive of streaming, but over time we will see that income, that record neighbouring rights income, go down as more people switch. I mean, I'm even doing it in my car now. I stream everything through my phone in my car. I'm stopping listening to, I listen to a lot of talk radio, but when I'm listening to music,
that's not doing anyone any good.
I then Radio 4. I tend to stream it. One of the questions the MMF is doing, and sorry, a bit of plugging here, but we released a report called Dissecting the Digital Dollar to try and explain this, which has had over 10,000 downloads. It is free. We'd like to really see that question about how streaming is treated by the labels opened up. And I know in Spain, which Maria knows much more about than me, that has happened in Spain. There's a change, and we think there's a real opportunity.
This is particularly for catalogue artists, in inverted commas, people that have signed old deals and their catalogue's been treated.
I think more broadly. It's just a sale, not a...
From what I understand from a records recording artist's point of view is because it's treated as a sale, the royalty is... It can be anything from, 15 to 21% of the actual income coming in. If it was a license, then it could be on a 50-50 split. So there is already a disparity at that, so as to what they're receiving. I mean, if you look at it conversely with music publishing, say a standard music publishing agreement would be a 75-25 split in favour of the writer. Slightly complicated in that a streaming service is half performance income, half mechanical income, so you have this income arriving in two sources. They would get 75% of what comes in. What is unfortunate is that music publishing, the weighing up of the income between labels and publishers has it's come through in a traditional way in which labels get more than publishers do. So, you get of 100%, maybe 30% will go to the service, which I think is fair enough. They've got to pay for their service, they've got to pay for the cost, they've got to pay for the licenses, blah, blah, blah. But then out of that, the lion's share still goes to the label. So a writer can be getting more, but proportionately less, because it's getting less of the overall pie. So, but it's very hard. What do publishers do? Nobody's going to turn around and go, here, you have a bit of my pie. it's just not going to happen. So, over time, and as every license negotiation comes along, you've got to try and get a bit more. But I just don't see where that's going to go.
Well, what you hear from recorded music bodies, present company excluded, but often on a global level is let's not infight now, let's wait for the pie to get bigger before we have these discussions. And I don't know at what point you
I
do
want
wait
a piece
for
of that pie. Though.
Yeah. Martin, you're on this panel, so therefore you are the spokesperson for all labels in the world ever. There are two points there, really. How artists are accounted to in terms of royalties from streaming services, whether it's treated as a sale or a license a broadcast license in the same way that you would have on radio, but also the amount of the pie that labels get. I think these are very rough figures, but there was a SNEP report end of 2014 which said of the 70% that comes from the audio services, labels are taking roughly about another 70%. Let's go on that point first. Is it justified, the amount that labels are taking from the overall pie?
Justified is a really value-laden word. It's a trade negotiation, and that's where it currently is. I've seen in the years I've been in the business many copyright tribunal disputes, and they end up somewhere. I've seen them deal with streaming, and this is where we're currently are. The rationale is interesting because if you look at the 70% figure, out of that, I know from Cooking Vinyl's point of view, we pay we tend to pay the costs of recording, marketing, and promotion. That's got to come from somewhere. And then we'll often do artist service deals. So after the costs are paid, we'll take 20% of the money and the artists take 80%. So of that 70%, most of it will pay through to the artists massively in their favour. So that's our most common deal type today at Cooking Vinyl. And I think it's easy to defend if you're doing artist service deals. If you're doing traditional record deals, it's harder to defend because the numbers are harder to get to. But often, you know, when we do breakdowns of royalty deals versus artist service deals, the actual real results are very similar. One of the reasons is that David Lowry did a big point that, you know, everyone focuses on the percentage that you earn, but they forget the unrecouped balances. So if, you know, most artists earn a far higher actual royalty than the royalty that they get from their record company because
they never pay
most artists are unrecouped. And that's something that, you know, you do have to bear in mind. The reason I like the artist services deal is that once all the costs are paid, then the heavy lifting's done and the record company are in back catalogue mode. They're doing much less work, and then the money is split massively in the artist's favour. But, you know, the other point, and I'll say this loudly, is that when the heavy lifting's going on, you know, we're taking a percentage of all the income before costs, so we're doing much better than the artist. And it's a model that, you know, has enticed Billy Bragg to stay with us for 25 years. It works really well long-term when you go to catalogue mode, but it does give us a decent margin. It gives us, you know, a 20% margin of income, which means we can work as a business. In terms of the rights, you know, that's a really hard debate. My only question is, you know, is neighbouring rights going down? Every time I hear a report from Sound Exchange or PPL, they're always gloating about how it's going up. And there's also loads of territories that aren't even monetizing neighbouring rights properly that coming on stream, like China and places like that. So I'd argue that neighbouring rights probably isn't going down, and that, you know, I can see the side of the point you make, but I disagree with the fact that it's substitutional for neighbouring rights, because I think neighbouring rights is going up.
Disagreement on a panel. Please, Maria.
I mean, the thing is that what's not been recognised at all yet is whether there is a neighbouring right. There is a broadcast applied to a stream. And I know in Spain, AYA, the neighbouring rights equivalent of PPL, has, and I don't know whether they've been successful or not, but they've been in disagreement with Spotify, saying that they feel there is a broadcast and that there should be equitable remuneration from that. But as far as I'm aware, I don't think any other territory has covered off that it is a broadcast. So the income that is being received is for the actual licensing of the music, of the recording.
Yeah. I would just say that it may be going up at the moment. That may be because they're doing a better job of collecting the money in. But I think if we are going to look very far into the future, as I say, and a lot of listening is done in cars, I think eventually we will see streaming increasing dramatically. So I think there's a thing at the moment where maybe that's not happening, but I think there will be a tipping point. And our opportunity to address this at the moment, sorry, is the European digital single market, not meaning to be very technical, but there is an opportunity to address this, and that will take some time to come through, but it's about thinking longer term, so we don't turn around in 10 years' time and go, hang on a minute, there's hardly any more broadcast radio, and what happened to this major revenue stream for our artists that we all just, you know, missed effectively?
In the US, Sound Exchange only, it doesn't replicate elsewhere.
Sorry, what sounds?
Well, in the States, Sound Exchange collects broadcast royalties on digital.
Yeah.
There are no terrestrial.
Yeah, non-interactive streams, right?
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. So non-interactive streams. So there's no terrestrial and there's no interactive activity collection. So it's a slightly different playing field.
But Sound Exchanges did just post record annual revenues, but I think the growth from year to year percentage-wise was smallest for about 10 years, so it is interesting to see that change. Charles, one of the things Annabella mentioned when she kicked off this segment is she talks about the advances that go from the streaming services to the record companies and the NDAs that are signed and the lack of transparency around that. I guess you wear two hats there. One, are those NDAs ever justified for your members and your organisation? But two, are you concerned about the amount of money that the majors are taking out and where that money is ending up?
Yeah, I mean, so for me, let's start at the top. And this is, I think if we're going to talk about the issue of transparency and value, we have to look at where the incentives sit. And I think that the shift to the digital market has really challenged the model of the major labels, which is all about controlling very tight channels to market and getting people to consume within those tight channels. So if you can, if you controlled radio, press and television and retail, you could really successfully herd consumers into very narrow channels of discovery. The digital marketplace has blown that open so that anybody can find anything and listen to anything they want, wherever they want, which has been fantastic for the labels that we represent. So as we've been looking and analysing streaming over the last 5 or 6 years, it appears to be extremely good for independents because it gives us this direct access to the market and to the consumer that we've never had. So for us, the digital market sees us performing better than we ever have in any more tightly controlled market, because we're not competing to be on the shelf anymore, because everyone's on the shelf. We're now competing to get the consumer to listen to your music, and if you make great music, as a lot of the people that we represent do, then you're going to be successful in generating more revenues from a broader set of people. Why does that matter? It matters because what the major labels have been trying to do as the digital market evolves is take out insurance policies against digital services, resulting in them losing money in the longer term. So they take huge upfront advances, they take disproportionate amounts of value out of the market in a way that misaligns the value not just between labels and artists, but between majors and independents. So the battle I think we're facing now is how do we build an ecosystem that effectively blocks that misalignment of value that's in the marketplace and gets it to flow in the right directions, right? So if we talk about transparency, it's never been easier to work out exactly where your music's played at any point in time and where it's generated value. We have, you know, and Ray probably has a better insight than this than I have, being a Luddite, but the amount of data that we can get access to on a day-to-day basis about where our music's being used means that we've got data to apportion value in whatever way you want to do it. So if you've taken an advance of $10 million and you've got $5 million left at the end that's unrecouped, there's $5 million worth of usage that's actually traceable down to a track level that you could very easily apportion that $5 million to if you so wished. I think that if you so wished is the real key that we're talking about here. So if we look at, you know, Merlin takes advances. We've had unrecouped balances on advances that we've getting.
So this is breakage.
Yeah. So breakage, and we're not. There's many forms that breakage can take, which we've sort of seen in our business. For us, it's very simple to be able to say, okay, if this amount of money applies to that service for that period of time, we've got the metrics by which we can apportion this. It's very, very, very simple. It's a matter of choice, and I think choice is the real issue here. And in terms of labels and how they treat artists, I mean, the independent sector has got a global overarching trade association called WIN. WIN launched the thing called the Fair Digital Deals Declaration last year, which thousands of independent labels around the world have signed, which is directly designed to address the apportionment of all of these monies and to say that, look, if I'm a rights holder and I'm collecting money from a label, it's absurd to say that I don't know where that money's come from, so I'm just going to put it in my pocket. I'm actually going to commit to pay this out in as transparent a way as possible. So I think what we really have in a lot of these instances is a misalignment of value. And I just want to touch quickly on this notion of music disappearing from the value chain in terms of neighbouring rights and non-interactivity. And America is a really powerful example of this, where it's still the only territory in the world that's generated a significant online player for non-interactive radio. So this is not a choice where, you know, to use the equivalent in the old world, it's like it's a difference between turning on the radio and getting in your car and driving somewhere, or walking into a record shop and buying a record and saying, I'm going to play this in this order and I'm going to skip this track and I'm going to move that track. The value that's been brought in by proper licensing of the non-interactive sector in the US via both Clear Channel and iHeartRadio and Pandora has brought, and XM Sirius on satellite radio, has brought enormous amount of value into the marketplace. We haven't seen those models replicated anywhere else. There's no successful online radio or satellite radio anywhere else in the world. And I think we have to keep a very clear distinction between a consumer deciding I'm going to play this song at this point in time or this series of songs in this particular order, or a non-interactive experience as we've seen in America deriving enormous amounts of value. We have to grow both ends of that spectrum, not just try and take from one to feed the other, because that's a zero-sum game.
And why haven't the non-interactive radio services taken off? I do know the answer.
It's culturally different. It's a licensing difference. So Pandora, I mean, one of my first meetings I ever had when I started my job at Merlin was with the people who were running Pandora at that point in time, pulling their hair out because they couldn't get publishing licenses in Europe to run their service. And I can understand from both sides of the spectrum why there was a value impediment in terms of getting that deal done. But the fact is, in America, there's a different licensing regime that allows those people in via a statutory license to use that, and it's brought an enormous amount of value. I do think, you know, there's a collective responsibility, as I said, to grow both sides of that spectrum, because that, I think both sides of that spectrum eventually long-term replicate what you're saying, and I agree, is getting in the car and listening to a digital form of radio should generate more royalties than listening to standard BBC broadcast does. But we don't have that model in the UK. I can't subscribe to XM or Sirius here, much as I would love to have more personalised radio.
And do you think interactivity really matters? I mean, the fact is, on TV Absolutely. Now, you can time shift everything. I just think everybody's expectations, when you do it with your BBC iPlayer, never mind Netflix, mm-hmm. I kind of think in the music industry, we tie ourselves up in knots saying, well, whether or not you can fast forward or not. This is why we would argue streaming should be treated regardless of whether I put on my Spotify playlist and drive to Margate and listen to it all in one go, or I'm able to get my phone out and skip the occasional track.
I'm not talking about skipping tracks. I'm talking about being able to say, today I'm going to listen to this artist and that artist and that artist. I'm going to create my own playlist in this particular order, and I'm going to create my own experience. It's like buying a CD.
So if you listen to someone else's playlist, that's the same as radio? Because it's curated by someone else and the same as listening to Six Music?
No, it is different on Spotify because you can shift and play around with that, and you can say, I don't like the song, I'm going to pull it out, I'm going to add that song to that playlist. I mean, I don't think the audience is here to listen to arguments.
No,
I think they are, Charles, to be fair.
Okay, so I've got five songs and you've got five, so how are we going to split them? Look, I mean, I think that there's a very, very broad argument on that, and there's aspects of services that... there's kinds of services that I think replicate a pure radio passive experience. And I think, you know, Mark said earlier, we're in a transition phase here, right? No, there's no silver bullets. Much as I respect everyone on the panel, none of us have got the answer. I don't know. I mean, you know, we do the best we can. But, you know, I think the overall notion is let's push the value up. And what's the best way to push the value up is what we should be focusing on. And I think that's my only point.
I agree with that.
Stick around. Charles is being modest. We do have the answer. Be out in about 10 minutes' time.
Martin's got the answer.
I wanted to switch subject. Seems a wise thing to do. Mark, the number one album in the UK and the US today. I'll help you out. It's the 1975 second record, which was windowed on Spotify. We don't know what that record could have done had it been on Spotify since day one, and none of us genuinely do have that answer. I don't think anyone at the label or the management has that answer. But do you anticipate that windowing is going to become more of a pattern, and will it damage the industry? This is where records are kept off predominantly free or freemium services. Only made available for sale for a certain period of time, or only made available on premium services?
I think Windows seems to be encompassing a bunch of different strategies. I think it's difficult to chuck them all into one place. For example, you know, Adele's decision not to put her record on Spotify is a very different decision to 1975. It's a very different decision to somebody maybe waiting 6 months or 3 months or putting it on premium only or free only. It's... Again, it kind of comes back to my point that I mentioned earlier, where we're in an optimization phase right now where people are trying to figure out what's best for them. One thing that I would never argue with, that's a lie, I would argue with it. I'd try to argue for a strategy to put your music, make it available, but I'd never argue with the right of an artist or a manager to make a decision that they think is right for their artist at that time. I would certainly argue that these decisions aren't necessarily the right thing to do. My fear with the industry at the moment is that there are some situations which, right or wrong, are influencing wider behavior and forming a pattern. It's not a pattern that's emerging, it's a pattern that's being driven. I think we're in a really dangerous position right now when I go back to talking about reducing that value gapage or increasing the value, getting us into a position now where we're talking about real Netflix-style numbers of subscribers around the world. And we're kind of going into this dangerous place right now where competition should be driving an improvement in services for consumers, and it's making it worse for consumers. We're getting into a position where for once it was starting to look viable to get your credit card out and pay $9.99. You could get the Beatles now. You could get your favorite albums. You could do that. And now you can't get even the 1975 album. You can't get Adele's record. Or you can maybe get it over here. There's a couple of albums you can get on Tidal. We're really getting to a position where we are creating value for the consumer and we're getting them to pay for it, and now we're contriving to take it away as an industry. Now, it's no one artist's responsibility to grow the industry. I would never say, hey, you know, you're holding things back. But I think there are ways that we can do this where we can have strategic release cycles that benefit people in different ways. So, for example, you know, one thing that managers and artists want a lot is they want a preferred partner. They want somebody who's going to help back them on a release campaign. Hey, we're going to do that preview with Complex, and then we're going to do that show at Facebook. Like, that's important that artists, managers, labels have partners that are going to go the extra mile for them. But it's really crucial from a consumer and from a value proposition of streaming where it is now that we don't lose sight of what caused this, like, massive piracy fuck-up in the first place, which was by making it so difficult for the consumer and so expensive for the consumer. So, yeah, I certainly see a potential pattern. But I think that pattern is picked up by the behavior and the decisions that we make right now. And you can still gain a lot of these strategic short-term advantages without necessarily doing taking the windowed route. And this whole free premium thing is certainly a little bit of a distraction in terms of a strategy for some of these guys. But we need to look at it. We need to understand that there's different ways of doing it, but we have to be super careful of the value that we're giving to consumers and deteriorating from that.
But when Kendrick Lamar comes to you and says, can I release my album through you, please? That's all right.
Can he release it through us?
Well, he just did, didn't he?
He put it everywhere. I mean, he put it everywhere. He put a record up with 8 new songs that are better than anything else that's been released in weeks on, but he put it everywhere. You know, his sensibility was he kept getting asked for those untitled tracks that he'd been playing on Fallon on all the late night shows. And so he went and he put it up. Put it up as a celebration of his Grammy wins. They put it up as a celebration of his recent success. And that's interesting because he put out 8 tracks that are a core body of work on there without, you know, this huge amount of fanfare. This is something that I think is really worth looking into. There is a ton of additional value around a core record that I think a lot of managers and artists have an ability to really leverage and play with and do cool stuff with. You know, Apple are doing VR videos and Snapchat are doing cool stuff and Facebook able to do stuff, Spotify able to do sessions, South by House, all of these different things. There's ways to add value and retain value for particular partners without necessarily throwing the baby out with the bathwater and not making your record available. That's when consumers start to look at whether it's you, whether it's these services, and start to think, well, why am I shelling out? And, you know, we might see a bump in Tidal where they go from number 400 in the App Store to number 1, but I don't know what it is now. You know, that's
not in revenue.
You know, it's in free or whatever, but what you do is you create this initial bump where you get people in. This is like going back to the days, like, hey, get a free trial on Rhapsody, and then 2 weeks later, no one used it and no one paid for it. It's literally taken us a decade and a half to convince some of those early adopters that streaming was actually valuable because they tried it, they didn't like it. You lose those people. So there's all these like kids that are coming in, they want to listen to these records, they want to listen to the hottest thing, they can't get it. They go back to YouTube, they go back to piracy, they go back to whatever they were doing before, just putting on Radio 1. It takes years to get those people back. But again, I want to come back to say, I don't think this is a responsibility of the 1975 Adele they have never said that's what they're after. But it is important as an industry that we aren't just kind of like hammering home this one strategy. It's not just one window, and it's not necessarily the right thing to do, but we should talk about it and optimize for the chain, for everyone in the chain.
Martin, those two cases are slightly different in that Adele held her record, her management company label, and I'm sure Adele herself decided to keep her record off streaming services entirely. The 1975 went with paid for streaming services only for 2 weeks, which is something we saw Coldplay roughly do last year. I think that was a week, that one. Right? But there's an additional element to this, which may or may not have swayed the 1975 decision, which was that Apple gave them a huge exclusive and put a lot of money behind distributing a concert recorded exclusively for Apple. There may or may not be Apple money involved in their videos. I'm not saying there is, but there certainly is with other artists, Coldplay being a prime example. How do you feel about windowing onto premium services only, or only going with a Tidal or an Apple Music as a label? And is it harder if Apple were to come to your door and say, look at this check, we're going to make all the videos for this artist, this campaign?
I think there's two ways of looking at it. One way is that each month there's a defined pot in Spotify, and every time Adele or Taylor Swift decides to window, that's more money for the rest, for the independent sector. So there's a big win there.
Yes and no, though, because obviously if Adele and Taylor were on there, there would be a bigger pot.
Well, I'm not sure how many more monthly subscriptions you'd add just through those records. It's a good question. But, I mean, I have been tempted to have a campaign for more windowing on that basis. But in the terms of the long-term interest of the industry, let's remind what we started off talking about, which was actually, you know, YouTube and how can we monetize premium services against YouTube. And obviously, I totally agree with what you said about the consumer experience. You know, if it is about winning consumers' hearts and mind long term as an industry. You know, if you're managing a band and you've got one career, you've got to do what's right for that band and for that record. But the big picture for the industry has got to be about winning consumers' hearts and mind, just like you said. And from that point of view, I think windowing's a disaster. Exclusives are a disaster. You know, specific things that don't turn off that enhance the consumer are fine, you know, which some of which have Apple have done or the other services have done, but things that actually hurt the consumer and confuse the consumer long term are not about us enabling business. They're the opposite. They're not about building the business. They're really hurting us. So I would argue very strongly, as an industry, we should really try to enable the consumer experience, and that's how we're going to actually build, you know, the pie, so that we do have a bigger pie and build the number of consumers we have, and, you know, really excite them to want to not just consume music on YouTube, but really excite them about monetizing it and paying for it and being part of, you know, getting that relationship back again with artists and labels and with the industry.
Just to add, I think the challenge should be, you can't, you know, windows and exclusives and all the things, they're creating value by taking value away from somewhere else, right? So they're saying there's a value in us having this because this other service doesn't have it. Whereas there's actually a ton of value that can be added on top of that normal thing. So yeah, these videos are really cool to be able to do that, or tour support, or all of these kind of things. There's a huge amount of opportunity for us to add value on top without taking it away and without screwing it for the consumer. We need to work with artist managers to figure out what that is and how we can do it, but also our competitors would be great if they were looking at it as well. We are not chasing exclusives. That's not what we see as the right thing to do for the industry, and it'd be great if everybody kind of took that chance, went, okay, well, what if we put this money into additional value? But
I'm going to talk about pies again.
That's all right, everyone's getting hungry.
So basically, this is a relevance whilst physical and downloads are still more the predominant methods of people to consume music. But once that goes, that reduces, and premium streaming services have get the volume that they need, because we're not anywhere near where, you know, where it could be. I mean, interestingly, I'd love to know that if Adele had left it on streaming services, what difference that would have made, you know, whether that would have exponentially grown. Because when I worked on the Radiohead experiment in Rainbows, and they windowed very early on in 2009, and for about 4 months, actually. And when that was released, you know, on streaming services, and there weren't so many streaming services, but it was extraordinary. That first month was enormous. So people were holding out to consume the music in the way that they had got used to consuming it, even at that point.
Their preferred service. Mm. Right. There was talk earlier. It was a bit of a distraction on the window, I think, but I wanted to cover it. There was a lot of talk earlier about transparency. Transparency from digital services to labels and rights holders, and mainly transparency from the labels to their artists and to those artists' representatives. This is all very well. We can drive towards transparency. We can reach the transparency promised land. But does that not give you a headache when you were talking about all those millions of lines earlier? Is transparency practically possible?
I'd be very careful what I say sitting next to Martin here. Salary's on the line. Charles brought a good point up. I mean, the information we're getting from Google at the moment, I mean, they timestamp the date of the sale. I mean, to the second when it was actually, you know, streamed. And there is no lack of transparency there. I think it is choice, actually. But it's how a label can cope with that data coming in. Someone like Cooking Vinyls, for instance, has tripled in a year. Not the money, but the actual size of the information they're getting in the door. I mean, that's a quarter of a million lines a month more than they, you know. So just, and they're not the only, you know, that's echoes across the whole industry.
I think the most troubling point is when you said that the money's the same, but the data has tripled.
Well, you know, there's certainly a dilution going on these days. Everyone knows there's a dilution. I think Charles will probably, you know, and... yeah, I think Mark's also touched on that. You know, I actually, with Martin there, I actually think if those albums were released, it would have just diluted the rest of the rest of the pot, actually. I think also what I see, without streaming, I don't know what the labels, what sort of trouble they'd be in. It's pretty much it. You know, we've got, you know, you have a year of physical sales, which are still strong, they were apparently dead 3 years ago. And, you know, if streaming wasn't around, I don't think a lot of the labels would. I'm really moody today, aren't I? I need a happy pill. But I think transparency is there, but it's how do we deal with it? What do people want to see? Does a record label or an artist want to see zillion pages of timestamps and where it came from and it was Joe Bloggs in Portugal who downloaded it? Of course they bloody don't. So I think it's how we present that to people and how we change our views on what actually people want to see, because I don't think we actually know that. You know, artists want to know what money they're getting paid. That's it. Don't care about anything else, I don't think. Occasionally take an interest, whether it, you know, if they feel like they always feel like they're getting duped out of something, probably too. But breakage as well. I think it's there. I think that's transparent, and it's, again, it's choice whether it's getting passed through or not. Most of the labels I deal with do pass it through, obviously. And it's just that. What do people want to see? You know, I hear transparency a lot, and there is a problem with it. Especially in publishing, you're getting fed what you're being passed through, so of course you're going to question what's in the pipe. But I think it's there. I think from the top upwards, it's good. It's just where we take it, and I don't think we know. I don't think we're ready to know really what we want from it.
I'm going to ask all panellists a brief question, and then we will take a couple of questions if anyone has any, starting with Annabella. I am concerned, as a fan of the format, that the album is going to die when streaming takes over. Do you share that concern?
Yeah, someone said that to me the other day, and I thought back to, what was it, 1998, where The Wedding Present released a single every month for a year, and wondered whether or not we're moving into that new world. And then, actually, do you then just aggregate all those singles and reform albums out of it? I don't know. Who knows? It does... potentially, the way people consume is opening up new opportunities. We've just done a series of case studies with some managers... about an album release where they found that a coffee shop in Spain was listening to him put on a playlist track 4 of the album, which wasn't the single, in which there was nothing being promoted through it, and they ended up with well over a million streams and it massively taken off. So I think it takes the power away, maybe, from maybe even from the artists and their managers and deciding this is going to be the hit, and in a way hands some of it back to the fans. It's interesting. We'll see. There will always be a role for a whole body of work, but maybe it just makes it more interesting.
Fan-made A&R. Frightening. Charles, are you worried about the death or decline of the album?
No, I'm excited about what people decide to do next. I mean, I think that the beauty of the system now is you're not bound by needing to create a piece of something to put into a retail environment. So I think you can choose to do that, or you can choose to do far more interesting and creative things over time. And I think, you know, we're already seeing that, I think, in terms of the electronic music world and people doing, you know, really interesting and different things in terms of how they present themselves. So my glass is always half full. I think, you know, people are going to show us amazing stuff.
Maria?
I don't think the album's going to die. I mean, it depends. You know, it's relevant and relative to the artist. You know, I mean, some artists, that's how they create music. They write albums. Others, it's a bunch of singles and some fillers. And, you know, that's just the way it is. And the fact that you can now consume single tracks and not have to get an album, although you do have album-only titles within that, it just gives the consumer a choice. And I think that's a good thing. I think it's all about choice. I mean, what would stop someone making a whole load of works available and people creating their own album out of it?
That's the stage we're getting to. And the value of that curation, whether by a fan or by a company. Ray?
I hope the album stays around. I mean, you talk about choice. I don't think it is a choice. I consume music myself in different ways. I've got, I own an album, I stream it too. I mean, I don't see a choice. I own the album physically and I'll still stream it, hopefully.
You can buy a single track if you wanted to.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes I think it's... I mean, if I'd streamed the albums I've brought, if I actually look at it, if I streamed it, probably the artist might have even made more money on the amount of times I would have listened to a song.
I mean, I buy and stream.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't see it as a choice. I don't think I do one or the other. I'm not going to buy it. I mean, I've got an iPod and I don't think there's a direct choice. I just think it's consumership that we'll look at all different ways of, you know, I listen to it on my Xbox, I'll listen to it anywhere. I wouldn't make a choice to do one or the other, though.
So. Martin, your business has been built on the album for 30 years. Are you at all sentimental to see its consumption pattern disappear?
Well, I mean, the first point is that the migration from downloads to streaming is actually really enhances the ability. You suddenly, you know, don't have to make an economic decision whether you want to listen to an album or not. It's just, you know, it doesn't cost you any more on a streaming platform to listen to the album than to listen to a single. So that the move from downloads to streaming really actually enhances the album as a format. I should know the answer to this, but, you know, there's a big question, which is the album as a playlist. I mean, how many playlists on Spotify are actually just albums? And you know, I know for a fact that every album in our catalogue, you can go onto YouTube and play the album in full on YouTube. So I do know that the album as a playlist on YouTube is incredibly popular. So it's... I think that what's exciting is basically what everyone else has said, choice. And what's exciting is to move from a situation where a very small number of nutters were buying albums to a situation where we're actually turning on the mass market across in the rich countries in the world, and hopefully that'll lead to, you know, a very big reach worldwide to paying for music again and actually connecting us and artists with, you know, the mass market worldwide is a really exciting proposition. And, you know, it is about adding value to the consumer, making their, you know, giving them that choice. And they've got far more choice and far more power now. And I think that's great.
Mark, one of the biggest music fans I know. Do you feel at all responsible for the death of the album?
Thanks, Tim. I think the question presupposes that people were listening to all these albums before, right? 99% of most albums that have ever been made have only ever been listened to by their girlfriend and their mum, right? But because it's the only choice, we assume that there's all this album listening. I actually think we're now in a position where we know if stuff's being listened to. That gives artists, A&Rs, labels, managers, a chance to optimize the way that they release records. That might be via album, might be via EP, it might be by single, might be by remixes. It gives artists and their teams a chance to create a format that suits their music and their fans in a more effective way and get listened to more, whatever the format. The truth is that I don't know, and I don't think anyone really knows right now, to what extent behavior is driving things like playlists and picking and choosing and album listening, and to what extent the facilitation of that behavior is driving it. So by creating loads of playlists, are we driving lots of playlist behavior, or are we just facilitating it? I think it's an interesting place, and it's something where, if you look back through the history of the music industry, the most creative and successful artists, from the Beatles to Hendrix to Stones, have been right at the forefront of those discussions. Not just been waiting there, oh shit, they killed the album. Like, they've been driving it, right? So it's an exciting place to be, I think.
Thanks. Does anyone in the audience have a question? I see one here, I see two here. That might be our limit. Okay, that's good news. This gentleman first, please. Well, Shazam is a tool, right, to direct you to streaming services.
If it's moving into a streaming thing now, where you can actually buy the album and then get it on your phone or your whatever device you want.
How has Shazam impacted your business, Martin, just briefly?
Probably none. Not many people.
It's not. I wish it was more, because Shazam is very much a mass market tool. You know, if you've got a very big single or a very big app, ad, it's very powerful. So for some of our biggest records, it's been very useful as a tool. But for most of the stuff we do, unfortunately, it doesn't hit their demographic, which is very much a mass market demographic. So I wish they could help us more. But, you know, it's one of those things. It is like piracy. You know, if you're being pirated, you're in the mass market. I wish we, in a way, in the old days, we've been pirated a lot more as well. But I wish Shazam could help us more.
And then there was one question here, I believe.
Yeah. So my question, most of the representatives here are from music companies, but as an artist, I'm an artist. I think, so last year I was lucky enough to interview an economist who predicted most of what we're talking about 40 years ago. And he said that what the music industry was facing was a crisis of proliferation.
This is a piece on the BBC.
Yes, that's right.
It was a great piece. Well done. really good. Just go and find it.
He said we were facing a crisis of proliferation, which just basically means there's so much music. He said there will be so much music that we'll struggle to generate enough value from any given piece of music. Now, as an artist, the concern I have is I have just a record or a track, and I need to generate sufficient income from that single product. If I'm a company and I've got lots of artists and lots of tracks, then streaming might be kind of cool because, you know, even though listening habits are dispersed, I've got a sufficiently large catalogue that still adds up to a significant income as a label or an intermediary service. But as an artist, that doesn't, you know, dispersed listening patterns could be a big problem. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely. Annabella, as the catalogues on streaming services grow every single day as new music is being made, yeah. Does it not suit the large catalogue owners much more than it does all the way down to a single artist making a single copyright?
A lot of our managers might only be managing one or two or three bands, so they're, you know, their interests are aligned with those of the artists. There always has been many, many people out there making music, even in the, you know, the days of the 90s where everyone said how well the recorded music industry was doing. There are an awful lot of acts out there that never got signed, partly because of all the gatekeepers in the industry. What streaming does is lower the number of gatekeepers, and in a way it makes it easier, provided you've got a strategy around it, for you to get your music out there and get it out there around the world. I was talking to Adam Tudhope the other day, who manages Mumford's and Laura Marling and others, And he was saying to me that some indie acts, actually, streaming's amazing. The fact that you can release globally and you can reach out to communities of people really into your kind of music in Brazil, in Argentina, in New York, in LA, and you can get the data on that and build your tours around that and use that to negotiate your deals if and when you do come to needing a major label deal and need to get finance or looking at other sources of finance. I mean, no one ever has a right to an income, but the chances of improving your access to your fans through legal streaming services, it makes it much, much easier. The cost of recording and distributing your music are lower than ever before. So it's about having that strategy and doing it in a really intelligent way.
Upsell. Towards ever so. I think that... Mark, please.
I just want to say that I think on a very macro level, the multiple of how many more people are making and releasing music now is actually tiny compared to the potential multiplier that we've got on getting people around the world to pay for music. Like, we had these very confined specific markets in the US, Japan, Germany, the UK. So on a macro level and slightly futuristic level, in the future actually there's going to be a lot more people paying for music than there is an increase in people producing music. On a more micro level, actually, one thing you've got to remember is that streaming isn't your only source of income. It has to be a part and parcel of your income. But even more good news, on every year that more streaming companies drive more premium subscription, drive more value, the bar at which an artist can make enough money from streaming to have a career lowers. And thousands more artists fall into this career, into a situation where they're making real money from streaming. And that's not happening over a decade. It's happening every few months. So actually, I think there's some hope on the horizon on all those fronts.
Less than 1%, I think 0.7%-ish of the world's population who could pay for streaming services, audio services, are currently paying. So there is much cause for optimism there, or gloom, depending on the perspective you take.
Monday.
Yeah, no, we're racing on that one. That leads me to thank the panel, Annabella, Charles, Maria, Ray, Martin and Mark. Been brilliant. Thank you very much for listening. Obsession. We weren't taught. I don't want to change the world. I'm not looking for New England. I'm just looking for another girl.